All right, let's turn to Romans chapter 5. I actually was thinking about maybe the last class that I had having a test, and that test would consist of explain to me what you got out of Romans 5, Romans 5, 5 through 10, what you got out of it in this class. Because in truth, if you didn't get anything else, you should have got something there. You should have got something eternal there. But this was going to be the last class tonight, because next week I was going to be going to Houston. However, there's a possibility I may still be here Thursday. So you will have to bear with me a bit longer. Romans 5 and verse 5. And hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Spirit who is given unto us. Then he begins to describe that love in terms of Jesus. For when we were without strength, in due time Christ died for the ungodly, scarcely for a righteous man. And he goes through, and you know the rest of that. But it is this spirit by which God functions, this nature, it is the nature of his being, and the Holy Spirit has shed that reality abroad in our hearts, so that we would not just be recipients, but that we would be able to partake of the divine nature. And that being said, out of Romans 5:5, turn with me to Galatians 5:6. Galatos, amen. And here it describes the faith. So before I read that, I'm just going to read a couple of things, really the last two, three sentences from the last class, and then get into this. Faith trusts that. And if you remember in our last two classes, we talked about weakness. Anybody remember that?
Yes.
Faith trusts that in its weakness, a great victory will come from God and others. It will come from God and unto others through resurrection. Faith doesn't believe that you'll do something in the name of God to help somebody out. Faith believes that in your weakness and in your trust of the faith, that life comes out of death, that strength comes out of weakness, that the gain comes out of loss, that in your weakened state or in your death, that a great victory will come, and it'll come literally for God or for others on one front or the other. Faith believes that. Therefore, faith does not require that we be strong, which is kind of a thing, because we always think of people with faith as really super duper people. When our trials are turned into opportunities for us to lose our life for others, then Christ is seen in them. Immediately, the Holy Spirit just quickened to me the three Hebrew children. Everybody else is going to bow down. Everybody else wants to be accepted. Everybody else wants to be seen as part of the kingdom. Everybody else is going with the flow. And three Hebrew children, they don't bow down. Okay? You can say that's strength, But in their strength of stand, they were thrown in the fiery furnace that was seven times hotter than before. That's weakness. Do you think maybe they had a thought, maybe we shouldn't have done this? I mean, you know. Yeah. But Nebuchadnezzar looks in there and he says, didn't we throw three people in there? And they said, yeah. And they said, well, there's a fourth walking around who looks like the Son of God. Okay, there it is. Jesus coming out of this situation, more than a victory, more than strength, human strength, more than people standing, more than a good testimony, it's Christ. But it was in their weakness. It was in their loss, as it were. It was in their rejection. It was in bearing that weakness before man. And the Lord came forth. And there ended up being a victory out of it. But in truth, the victory, folks, we're so not tuned into this. In truth, the victory is when we are after his kind and we stand with him in this kind of spirit and nature. He sees that as the victory. The resurrection, the all of that stuff, that's no big deal for him. And he doesn't go, oh, thank God Jesus got out of this. Oh, I was worried, you know, he knew. Why? On what basis did God know that was going to work out? He, you know, the faith of the Son of God. God knew that if there was a death, and it was a certain kind of death, there would be a resurrection. He knew it. He lives by it. He walks by it, if you will. You know, the just live by faith. And God lives by it. And so, It's just as sure as if there's a night, there's going to be a day. But nobody wants to go through a night. See, we're afraid of the very thing that God holds as dear. I mean, if we ever really saw that, you know, I mean, I think we all can shake our head yes to it. But if we ever really saw that, it would be devastating to us as we recognize that we are so contrary, not just contrary, and not just so contrary, but contrary to a degree that is unimaginable to us because we call good evil and evil good. We favor the things that, and we savor the things that God doesn't. We do it all the time. We don't even know we do it. We don't even know we have a need for him. But we are in a season here where God is dealing with us on those things. And if you are faithful, and if your heart is true, and if you continue, Jesus said, if you continue in my word, you'll know the truth, and the truth will make you free. But he's not talking about continuing in the word like a Pharisee would continue. He's talking about having had an encounter with the Lord in such a manner that it devastates you so that you must have Jesus. All right, most of us have had encounters with the Lord and we go, oh, I need Jesus. And even when we're in the depth of the throes of the situation, it doesn't take very long for us to get over it and get out. And, oh, I just want to feel free, you know. Blessed are they that mourn. Oh, I want to rejoice, you know. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Oh, I want to have the victory. On and on and on. I mean, there's just no, and my little contrasts mean absolutely nothing. They're like little, you know. Maybe you even notice it. You know, it's like getting a mosquito bite without even really noticing it. Well, I don't see any value in it, and I don't see any problem with not getting what I'm saying. But if we're going to be faithful to follow him, that always leads to the cross. Doesn't it? I mean, he's always going to take you there with him. And you say, well, but I'm raised up and I'm looking at him on the throne. But you're looking at a lamb, and you're not, I'm not talking about it'll always lead to the two pieces of wood. It'll always lead to the slaughtered lamb, or it will always lead to the nature that is God, which you cannot serve God and claim to want to conform to him and not recognize that it's always going to lead to the cross then. You understand? The cross as a meaning the nature of the lamb in such a manner that you are struck at the crossroad with the decision, shall I choose what I don't like? Death and rejection and loss and those kind of weakness. Do I reject that and go after what I want, which the vast majority of people do? Or do I accept something that I don't fully understand, but my spirit bears witness, and I will follow. I will go as far as I can go, because you see, if you go a distance, there will be grace at that distance that you don't have if you don't go. Yeah. Even if it's a short distance, there will be grace there. But there's not grace at the crossroads. There's only your desire for Jesus or lack thereof. All right, so we want to talk about faith expressing itself by love. I think the scripture here in Galatians 5:6, it says this: for in Jesus Christ neither circumcision availeth anything nor uncircumcision, but faith which worketh by love. Okay, now why would it say that? I mean, do we ever just go, why are you saying that? Or we just go, well, that's the Bible. I don't know what it means, but that's the Bible, and therefore I believe it's true. Well, no, you don't believe it's true if you're doing just the opposite of it. Well, I mean, is that right or wrong? I mean, you don't believe it. You haven't even fathomed it, much less gotten a place to believe it. You can't fathom it. Why is he saying that? That's the big question when you read it. For in Jesus Christ neither circumcision availeth anything, nor uncircumcision, but faith which works by love. Why is that statement made in the manner that it's made? Well, I'll tell you exactly why. Using modern day terminology. Faith which works by love is the new circumcision. Wow. it's what it always meant. It's the reality. Anytime it does away with something, that was a shadow. And you have to find the reality. Well, that's the reality. It's saying those things don't avail anything. The only thing that avails is the real thing. Faith, which works by love. Okay. Now, let's dispel our wrong definitions of love. It's not talking about sloppy agape. It's not talking about ooey-gooey Christianity. It's not talking about all of us hugging or, you know, I mean, don't some of you guys miss the days when you would greet with a holy kiss? Guess not. But it's not that. It's not that. It's not any of that. It is, by this perceive we the love of God, because he laid down his life for us. And we ought to lay down our life for one another. That's love. That's love. And when you put faith into that, in other words, I believe that there's a belief system that believes that life comes out of death, but it has no faith in the principle. I believe that. There's no faith. Faith works by love. But just believing in a principle of life comes out of death has no power without faith that believes in selfless love, losing to yourself that someone else might gain, or better defined, Christ in you, the hope of glory. In other words, we don't come to that, and we don't even change into that. We come to Christ being our life in such a manner that he has the freedom to live, to just live. You know, I mean, we look at this body as a house, and Jesus lives in my house, but we restrict him to like certain rooms. You know, we have our party room. We don't want Jesus in there. You know, we have our pity party room. We don't let Jesus in there because he'll say, stop. You know, not only that, he won't just say stop. He'll say stop and shut this room down now. Okay. Or even better, he would say, stop, give me the key. I'm going to start inhabiting this room also. Yeah. Well, we say, but then I won't ever get any love, pity party. Right? I mean, isn't it all just a big ball of flesh? I won't get any love. Yeah, you'll get love. He'll lay his life down for you, but there's a problem, and we read it in Romans 5. He's going to expect that love to be shed abroad in your heart. And he doesn't even say, for me. He says, for others. I laid down my life for you, and you ought to lay down your life for the brethren. See? Because I would do that for Jesus, you know. Now, I was thinking about this the other day. We read the story there in Genesis of Adam and Eve, and how could they do that? And I would never do that. I would never choose my own way over God. You do it every day, still. Every day, choose your own way over God. You're Adam on steroids. If you understand, I mean, there was this one event there. You and me have no place for judging anybody, not Adam. I mean, even you check it out in the scriptures and see how much place you have even for judging and rebuking Satan. No, you check it out. I know there's, but you check it all out. See. And what I mean by that is just very simply, we judge, whether it's the devil, Adam, or someone in this room, we judge because we think we're better. Because we think we've got a right to judge or a position to judge, you know. All right, I was really wanting to cover some ground here. Let me read. Other than through weakness, what is another way faith expresses itself? Faith expresses itself in love, in terms of self-giving. Faith expresses itself in terms of you embracing or even looking for an opportunity to lose that someone else might gain. You're ready with the faith to say, if I do this, this death, life will come out of this death. Gain will come out of this loss. You see what I'm saying? There's a faith, that, and it's working by the love that's working in you. It's not just faith works by believing certain doctrines or believing ink on white paper. Faith works by love. Faith works by love. That statement could be said another way. Faith expresses itself in love or cross-giving. All acts of self-giving must be acts of faith. And they must be acts of believing that life comes out of death, or again, all of the different ramifications that we've set forth up to this point, not just I have faith that God does stuff if I go, I believe you'll do it. It's more to it than that. It's more to it than that. Well, if you pray according to the will of God, well, there you go. You're stuck right there. According to the will of God? We think, if you pray according to the will of God, we're thinking in terms of what the will of God is for my life. Yeah. I'm praying according to the will of God, and I know the Lord wants me to have this. Those acts are expressions of faith which is working by means of love. According to Galatians 5:6, there are certain things that matter in Christ, and there are certain other things that do not matter at all. What does not matter is circumcision or the lack thereof. Why? Because that was a shadow of the true that was to come, but with the new covenant. What is the true reality that circumcision pointed unto? These verses here in Galatians tell us the shadow that was circumcision pointed to a greater reality, which was the fact that faith works by love. Our old flesh with its selfish ways were ended because we, the flesh, were circumcised from the body. And this is talking about our nature. This is talking about that which is would try to remain in the body but would be selfish. There's a whole lot more to be said about that, but some people can't take it. What's circumcised is circumcised so the head may be seen. That's all I'm going to say. It is faith expressing itself in love. The faith of Romans 6:17 is a faith in the cross, but primarily as it is brought to bear upon us. The form of teaching that Paul exemplifies is cross-centered teaching. So I believe in a faith that expresses itself by love or by self-giving. Therefore, the greatest expression of faith is not in believing God for material blessings, but in a life of sacrificial giving. The just live by faith. Faith works by love. Anybody see a pattern here? Yes. In the case of Abraham, his faith expressed itself in the giving of his son Isaac. We see this in the book of James. In the book of James, he brings up Abraham, and he doesn't bring up Genesis 15. He brings up Genesis 22. Now is his faith fulfilled when he's willing to give up his son at a loss because the father asked for it. But being strong in faith, he believed that God was able to raise him from the dead. Okay, well, that's faith, and that's the faith of Abraham. That's another aspect that we mention from time to time. But it is that same faith on a larger scale now. Now it's not just me and Sarah are so dead that we can't do this. We can't bring forth the son. But now it's having the son. And then being willing to give up the thing that you love the most and God gave you and lay it on an altar, but believing that, as it says, I think in Hebrews, that believing that God is able to raise him from the dead if he did. In other words, his faith didn't just say, well, I have faith in God that whatever he says is right, so I'm going to give my son, and he's just going to be dead, but whatever God says is right, and that's my faith, and I'm standing by it. Well, that's not it. It is, I believe that if I give this and I give it in the right spirit and in the spirit that he desires, that this is what pleases him. And that's what Jesus did. And he exalted the Lamb. I mean, you know, the Lamb was put on an altar and slain. And then if you will see this, if you could only see it, that you go through the first door, the first veil, you walk in, there's the altar, you take your lamb and you slaughter him and you cut him up and you set him on fire and you do all this kind of stuff, you know, whatever is required, if it's a whole burnt offering or a peace offering or whatever, you slay him. But before it's all over with, that same lamb is taken into the Holy of Holies and sat on it and declared to be King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And everybody, every knee is supposed to bow to that lamb that gave himself. All right. So, the priests were supposed to have faith when they offered those things. They weren't just supposed to go, this is what God wants and we'll get nothing in return, or whatever weird mindsets that we have that is contrary to the mind of the Lord. It is, and of course, not being mixed with faith, they didn't enter in, you know. There was a lack of the faith in these things. They didn't see it in the captivity. They didn't see it in the Day of Atonement. Galatians 2:20 shows how faith expresses itself by conformity to the cross. Christ as the crucified now lives in those who express faith in his crucified ways. Faith in his crucified ways. Faith in his crucified ways. See? I live by the faith of the Son of God who loves. I mean, that's a way of looking at Galatians 2. I live by the faith of the Son of God who loves. Oh, wait, let's add a little more. I live by the faith of the Son of God who loves by self-giving. This is the manner in which he loves. And not by a Son of God that is expressed in any other way. I live by the faith of the Son of God that is this way. Not I live by the faith that Jesus was God's Son. Anybody see the difference of what I just said? I believe Jesus is God's Son. That's not the faith he wants. The devil believes that too and trembles. And it counts for nothing. But the devil didn't believe in life out of death. For had he believed that, he would not have crucified the Lord of glory. Right? Because he would have believed he's coming back. But he put him to death and believing for sure this is the end. See? Once I live by that faith, then I also become a crucified one. Meaning, you know what I mean. I shouldn't have to explain that. But it is that we walk by faith from then on. Do you see? That's the same thing. Do you see that? Yes. And in Paul's situation, he really did understand, though, what he was doing. You know, and we go, oh, I would like to be a missionary like Paul and go around the world and just do things. Okay, well, of course, most of that is rose-colored glasses because we don't really look at what he went through. But more importantly is that we don't recognize the gasoline, the impetus, the power that was sending him from place to place and around the world. And that was, in all these situations, he'd lay down his life. He's in the prison. He's going, him and Silas, they're singing and going, this is good, man. We're laying down our life. We're being unjustly judged and everything. And instead of condemning and going, you stupid jailer, you know, and joining in with all the prisoners, you know. They're just in there singing and going, you know, life comes out of death. There's going to be a resurrection. Rumble, rumble, rumble. You know. See, it wasn't just a miracle. It was faith in the way that God functions. And if you say, well, if a miracle happened at that, I mean, if the earthquake happened in that moment, it was a miracle. Yes, but it was God's hand being moved by that spirit, and based on what they were releasing there. See? But we'd sit in prison and talk about how unjust this is, and, you know, but I'm believing that God, and people would come and they'd pray for you and say, oh, I'm just believing with you that, you know, those people, they're going to get theirs, but, you know, God's going to really, you know, he's going to show them up. And everything that's not Christ . The faith does not become practical except as expressed in manifestations of love or in acts of self-giving. Manifestations of, what do I call it? Selfless love. The faith does not become practical except as expressed in manifestations of love or selfless giving. That is why we're told that faith works or operates by love. This means that that which is not cross love is simply self-centered and loves for the pleasure or personal benefit it gets from loving. You know, I've known people, I've had girlfriends that were in love with love. You know, I'm going, after a while you just go, you know, if there's any way that this could work without me, you'd be just fine. You know, and what is it? It's really just the love of the feeling of love. You know, it's the love of that feeling. Oh, I'm in love. I feel good. You know, well, what if you went through something bad with somebody? You still in love? No, because I don't feel good. You know, love feels good. Love is best seen at the cross, and Jesus didn't feel good. That is the grave contrast to cross love. James said that faith without works is dead. Without an expression that comes by means of love, then faith is just a belief system. And let me just, I'm going to just say this. Really and truly, there is no belief system. I believe that we can write it all down and say, you know, I mean, like the Methodists, every service that I was in growing up, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived of the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate. I still remember it. I can still say it all, you know. And I wasn't even saved. Neither were most of the people that were in there. You say, well, that's a judgment. Well, maybe it is. But we were being fed something that we could memorize and feel good about our religion. The cross is to be seen as a defining reality of the expression of love that God is talking to us about. See, you know, you can describe manifestations, you can talk about it and all this kind of stuff, but it's almost like everybody that's a Christian, they hear from God. But if I had my way, I would want to come to them, each one, and say, I would like to introduce you to the voice, the one that's been talking to you. I would love to introduce you to him. But you see, only the Holy Spirit can really reveal him. And of course, when I said that, I'm not talking about introducing people to salvation. Talking about the actual real Jesus as seeing him as he is and what a profound effect that would have upon us. All right, so this way of dying to self, this way of laying down our life, this crucified way, this way of love, this way of letting Jesus live in us, this way, it's all the same thing. All of those are exactly the same thing. They're just different phrases trying to awaken us with different terminology to the one, to the one. And this, all of those phrases that I use, this all is the means for the increase of life. Life comes out of death. Benefit, actually, does come out of it to others. Glory comes to God. It is the power of God. It is the means of change. It is the path that God wants us to learn to function by on a daily basis. Live by this. Do it all the time. Live this way. Release, release, release life. Release blessings. Release da-da-da-da. You say, yeah, but that's a pretty dull life for me. Not if you're one with the Lamb. It's not a bummer. I understand that if you're not one with Him, how that looks. Because it looked that way to me when I was first being introduced to it by the Holy Spirit. And I just went, I don't think so. I mean, Berean, where I went to Bible school, they weren't teaching this. Not this aspect of it. They weren't teaching this. And the Lord introduced it to me, and I said, who can be saved then? I can't be saved. This is calling for pure selflessness, and I can't do that. Well, see how dumb I was, because I thought He was wanting me to do that instead of Christ being formed in me in a manner that the crucified could live any way He wanted to. Oh, the freedom. Can you imagine Him walking in His house and saying, oh, the freedom. No more locked doors. You know? And that thought came to me today as I was meditating on the Lord. Just how much I hinder Him, hold Him back, limit Him was the word. How much I limit Him in me because I only give certain runners for Him to run on. And those runners are based on my already understanding of things. And I never, and I did this time, but I never sit down and go, you know what, I think I'm ready for You to just be Lord. I'm ready for You to be the life and to get the opportunity to function the way that You would like to instead of the way I like You to or I know You to do or I expect You. I mean, wouldn't that be horrible if those weren't runners? They were hoops that we were asking Him to jump through every time. And I think to some degree, at least in my case, I think that was true, even as I meditated today. And I didn't want to do that to Him anymore, you know? I didn't want to do it to Him anymore. And I just said, I give You the freedom, you know, whatever that means. And of course, we're all afraid of whatever that means. And basically, the worst of it is, you know, we got our hot little hands on the steering column and tight-fisted holding it, and we make Him our co-pilot as we're driving where we want to go and everything. And, you know, to actually let go, and I don't know that with any of us there's an actual just like let go like this. Yes, Lord. You know. It's usually He has to peel our, you know, sweaty little fingers one at a time off of that steering column and get us to, you know. And finally, you know, it's like after years, you know, He's got this hand nailed up to the cross and He's got the crown of thorns. And these fingers are there, but we got one little finger on the steering column going, oh, let's see, let's turn here. You know? He's going, dang, you're hard to deal with. That's what He's thinking. Dang, you're hard to deal with. This has been years, and you know, we haven't even made any progress toward where I want to go. But you see, I wouldn't suggest that anybody turn this over to him until you understand the faith. And here's what I mean. You won't anyway. I'm not worried. You know, I'm not worried that you will, okay? You won't. I'm absolutely sure. Trust me. I'm a professional. But I say that to say that if you did, you'd be miserable. But when can we say it like that? Not if, but when you really understand the faith, oh my God, he's just going to steer me the way he steered David or Moses or, you know, Paul or whatever. And you go, well, yeah, but they went through a lot of stuff. Yeah, but they all wrote about, you know, rejoice in this, but it wasn't the same thing we thought. We thought, well, somebody slaps you, go, oh, praise God, hit me again, baby. You know, no, it's not, you're some sort of masochist that you like pain. It's not that at all, not even close to that. You probably on one level never will like suffering, because number one, it will always be suffering to you because you can't fellowship with Jesus in the sufferings of Christ unless they're suffering. You know, we always think, well, I'm going to get to a place where I'm going to walk with Jesus and all of this stuff is going to come my way and I won't feel anything. Do y'all see that? How that mentality goes? And it's going, I'm going to get so spiritual that I, you know, when I go through stuff, you know, somebody will pinch me and I'll just go, I didn't even feel that. You know, no, you can't fellowship in suffering unless you feel suffering. Am I right or wrong? So there has to be something greater than some sort of a lack of pain response. There has to be something greater than you'll just feel all bubbly in the midst of it. I'm actually writing on all this right now, and I'm not writing because I wanted to write another book, because I haven't written in a long time and I don't want to write. I did a song the other day and they said, did you write that? And I said, I don't write songs. You'll have to figure out where it came from, but I'm not into all of this stuff. I'm not. I am into one thing. Christ living in me in the manner that he wants to. And the manner that he wants to is life out of death. Or strength out of weakness. Or loss coming, or, you know, gain coming out of my loss or something like that. And I'm quite content. And I've been with the Lord long enough that the faith is a real thing to me. And I'm just fine with it. I mean, it doesn't mean you don't, is the worst the situation, you know, if it goes from just being weak to dead, well, that's a lot worse. And I may have a few more rumblings than I would just in weakness, but it's okay. It's okay. I mean, part of it is I just look and say, you know, I just want the Father to get his Son. I mean, if that's all that comes out of this, then Father, I just want you to get your Son. If nothing comes out of it, that you at least look and say, oh my God, there's my son, my beloved son, the one in whom I'm well pleased, you know? And all glory goes to him. All right, so what brought all this up is that this faith, walking in this faith, or this love, is a means for increase. Since God's kind of love is not self-focused, then a faith which works by love will naturally work to the benefit of others as demonstrated by Christ on the cross. It's automatically going to take into consideration others first. You'd be surprised how little you take into consideration you first. Now, When, if I had have heard that at a certain juncture in my walk, I would have said, I'll never be able to get there. And I would have meant it, and I would have known it in throughout my whole being. I could never live that way, or I could never be that way. Well, while I've got a long way to go, I found out that I was right. I can't, but Christ can. And we all know that, but then we know that on this doctrinal level, but when we get into practical things, we get discouraged because we can't do it. So which is supposed to win out? The little doctrinal level that we have? What's supposed to win out is not this little doctrinal level, but putting that in a place that's wrapped in faith, Christ crucified, wrapped in faith, living in you, and released, knowing this is going to bring glory to God, this is going to affect people, and there is going to be an increase. I don't even have to know how or what generation or who in this room, or you know what I mean? It doesn't matter to me at all. I just want to live by this faith. I want it to work by love in me. This means that this faith is a means for transforming life situations for the benefit of others. Okay. So, you may be the victim, but 9 times out of 10, the person that is the persecutor that is making you a victim is probably bound even more than you. But we usually don't think of others like that. All we can think of is, why are you so mean? Well, it is, you know. And God's going to get you. Okay, yeah. But he's going to get you first. And he will do that. He will. And you can play that little game with God for years, 40 years in the wilderness. And he's still dealing with you. Well, it's the giants in the land that caused this. It's the things that are too big for me. It's the expectation of things that I can't handle. We just can't do that now. And he says, okay, you know, so they say, deal with the giants and we'll be back. And he says, no, I'm going to deal with you. What kind of dealing is he going to do with them? Well, for 40 years, he's going to teach them not to be naughty. No. He's going to deal with them until they all drop dead. Right? And then a new generation is the resurrection. You say, I want to be the new generation. I don't want to drop dead. It doesn't matter where you drop dead at, whether it's on a cross with Jesus or in a prison or in the wilderness, finally getting the faith and saying, and I don't know if that happened with them or not, but I will say this, that it is possible that it could have happened and it should have happened. And in God's mind, you see, and in his types and shadows, it did happen. They were one people. Israel, these died that these might enter in. That's God's mind. See, and we go, well, there's the bad guys and the good guys, and I'm with the good guys. I'm Caleb. You know, don't say you're Joshua because that's Jesus, folks. Okay. But I'm Caleb. I'm not even with the good guys. I'm Caleb. Really? Really? Wow. Did you have your hand up? Yes. I can't hear you at all. What she said. All right, the reality of life out of death allows the believer to embrace affliction. Okay, what? The reality of life out of death allows the believer to embrace affliction. That's only half the sentence. It allows them to embrace it because of great love and hope for God and others. First two commandments. In the first two commandments, all is fulfilled. On this basis, it not only accepts suffering, but chooses it. Did you know that? Why would it choose it? Because it sees opportunity to live Christ, and by doing so, glorify the Father. It sees opportunity to live Christ, which is the crucified, and bringing benefit to others. And Jesus, I mean, Jesus said, big, you know, you love your friends, you love your family, big deal. Even the heathen do that. What's different about us? Love your enemies. Love the ones that slap you. Turn the other cheek and take whatever venom is in them. Soak up all of the crap in this world and take it into death with you like Jesus did. But no, we want to shove it back in their face, but tenfold. See. And all of that anger, and here's the way I look at it too. All that anger that's coming out on you, that person has that anger apart from you. And they're going to bring it on somebody else if you don't do a relief valve where it goes, and then let all that steam off. You say, well, why should I suffer that? Well, you shouldn't. You should be happy and go do what you're going to do. But Christ in his body wants to do that. And he did take every bit of it. They slapped him. They beat him. They mocked him. They abused him. They, every kind of thing. They killed him. And he says, Father, forgive him. Father, forgive him. Okay. So he's saying, whatever consequences that they are due, even in the worst situation to me, don't let it come on them. Where's that going to come from in us? It's going to have to be Jesus. Is it possible to happen in us? Absolutely. Stephen is our man then, isn't he? This kind of suffering is full of hope and promise of resurrection. It is not akin to torture and agony unless it is deceived into believing that suffering for the sake of suffering is some sort of cleansing agent. Well, there are religions that believe that suffering just for suffering's sake is a cleansing agent. I actually know deeper life preachers that teach that. That Jesus learned obedience by what he suffered, and that you're going to learn it too, because just suffering, period, is a cleansing agent where you're going to get cleaned up and become what you're supposed to be. No, I don't believe that. This bears no resemblance to the cross of Christ. Suffering, as Christ knows it, is bathed in the faith that life comes out of death. So we conclude that to believe in a God who raises the dead is to believe that there is an acceptable death, and that death includes his means to impart in life. Okay, all right. There is an acceptable death. There is unacceptable death. Okay? Don't get derailed and just think that, you know, well, I'm going to just carry around a cross and do without and this and that, and then that, you know, that's going to please God. If it's not bathed in Christ, it's just us. Are we sincere? Yes. I think there's many a monk that was sincere, but I think a lot of them were just doing what they're doing because it's, you know, same thing with nuns and Buddhists and, you know, it's a real desire to please God. I mean, I think Cain was sincere. I believe Cain was sincerely trying to please God, and he found out, well, my method just wasn't the right one. So we conclude that to believe in a God who raises the dead is to believe that there's an acceptable death, and that death includes his means to impart life, because if it's acceptable, there will be a resurrection. This also means that God accepts death. That's a big step right there for a lot of people. They don't even believe God accepts. All this talk about death, I mean, I've had so many, you know, not so much last bunch of years, but for probably the first 20 years of my ministry, I had so many people that would go up and go, all you do is talk about death. And I said, well, if life comes out of death, there's no need me talking about life until there's been a death. Right? I mean, that's the way I felt. And I had other brothers that were preaching with me, and they would preach the life end of it, you know. And they would even say at times, why do you always preach the cross? I said, because there has to be a death. There has to be an understanding of our death. It's not just magically Christ in us. I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, but not I. Christ lives within me. That's the exchange. That's what's going to make the difference. So I admit it, and I admitted it to them. Yeah, yeah. I'm the bringer of death. I'm the angel of death, you know. Yeah, it's my fault. But I was not ashamed of it. I wasn't. Not then, not now. It's like, yeah, you know, I mean, I could have fit in, rolled with the group, you know, but I knew somebody has got to make sure that the cross is clearly seen for what it's supposed to bring about. All right, one last sentence here, or is it? Two sentences. Let me read this one again. This also means that God accepts death. He sees it as a rightful means to accomplish his purposes. My Lord, God sees death as a rightful means for accomplishing his purposes. Well, where do you get that, brother? Let's see. The cross. He accepts death. He sees it as a rightful means. Paul saw that and he says, so death works in me, but life in you. The issue is no longer that life came out of Jesus' death, but that it can come out of our death also. All right. Everybody happy you came?
Yes.
All right, let's